Thanks for the introduction. So as Dennis mentioned, I am a visiting faculty this semester. My office is in Allen 211 Allen Building. So if after this talk, if any one of you wants to meet with me to talk in more detail, I will be available. So please do stop by and let me know. So today's talk is titled Shannon-Inspired Statistical Computing. And this is a topic that is very dear to me because, in fact, when I was in AT&T Bell Labs, I was designing VDSL chips, very high-speed DSL chips. And in those days, we were trying to hit a data rate of 52 megabits per second over twisted pair wiring, and it was considered to be blazingly fast, all right? It turned out that in the process of designing communication ICs, you actually have to walk from systems, applications rather, to algorithms, to architectures and circuits. And when you take that journey, you immediately find that right in the center, you have this von Neumann-style processor that is trying to do something for a system that is end-to-end stochastic in nature, right? So the end performance, the transmitted signal, it's a stochastic signal, it's a message that is being transmitted. There's noise, which is also a statistical quantity. And then at the receiver, the bit error rate is also a statistical quantity. So all these, the environment in which we are designing the system is embedded in statistics, yet at the heart of it, when we do processing, especially the digital processing, the baseband processor is deterministic in nature. And so this kind of created a bit of discomfort in my consciousness. And so later on, when I came to University of Illinois in 1995, I kind of looked at this problem of why do we design systems the way we do? And if we did keep in mind the application requirements, the environment in which these systems have to be implemented, then can I do things differently? So that's kind of the motivation for this work. Today, of course, we have a number of researchers. In fact, many of the faculty at Stanford, about five of them I know of, who are members of a center that was established in 2013 to develop brain and I would say Shannon-inspired approaches to computing in a very pervasive manner. So I'll touch upon that particular center, its goal, its activities later in my talk. So I've organized my talk in these three categories. First, a motivation, I'll provide that. Then bulk of my talk is on this Shannon-inspired statistical information processing. I will take one case study. It is a chip design that we completed last year, 2013. I'll kind of do a deep dive to give you some more details. And then I'll kind of step back again and tell you a bit about the center, Sonic Center, which I mentioned earlier, and some of the future plans. What are the future prospects of this kind of research? So at the end of the day, I should mention, when we talk about Shannon-inspiredness and we talk about information processing, it's all about building reliable systems using unreliable components, right? So at the end of the day, this is the core of the problem that we are trying to solve. Now, it turns out that in today's era, where we have, you know, we all know that we are embedded in this data-rich environment, and the value that a lot of our computing systems bring to the consumer is in their ability to extract knowledge, to extract information from that data. And if that extraction can be done in a robust, energy-efficient fashion, if it can be done in our mobiles, in our handhelds, then that's the place to be. That's really the challenge that we all need to address when it comes to building computing systems in today. So the challenges are what I term as native intelligence. And by native, I mean having our mobile and handhelds not really requiring to connect to the cloud for intelligence. Providing energy efficient processing and providing feedback or results to the user in a low latency manner. So that's the challenge, but in that challenge is embedded an opportunity for achieving those, for addressing those challenges. So first of all, when you're talking about information extraction, the processors and the processing that we want to do are inference based. So you are providing decisions, you're providing likelihoods, you're providing choices to the user by analyzing the data, by analyzing the structure of the data and providing the user with ability to make decisions. And so that those kind of processing and processors have some relaxed notion of correctness. It's almost like a communication link where at the end of the day, we look for the rate at which bits are in error. So bit error rate is a statistical metric. Similarly, in these inference engines, the metrics tend to be statistical in nature. And so we can exploit it to reduce energy, to come up with new ways of information processing. And that also creates a need for us to build these inference kernels. That's at the highest level. At the lowest level, you know, we have to crunch through all of this data and generate decisions. At the lowest level, we have this, the cost of scaling, the fact that Moore's law has slowed down, the fact that we rely on device scaling so much so to reduce energy traditionally. Traditionally, device scaling has given us increased functional densities. You can pack a lot more functions in a smaller area. Device scaling has given us lower energy. It reduces energy, enhances performance. So we get, it's all a win-win situation if we can get to scale devices in the conventional sense, in the sense that we can use those devices in a von Neumann paradigm. But it turns out that devices, we all know, are governed by statistical physics. And it is just that when we build systems, we are used to suppressing those statistics, talking about a deterministic fabric. We build architectures on that deterministic fabric. We build software. We build higher-level systems. The software stack, all of that is built under the predication that it is a deterministic fabric. And that is, in fact, increasing the cost of scaling. So depending on whom you talk, you will hear things like, yeah, we know how to scale, but it is just too expensive. And one of the reasons being that it is really very hard to guarantee very low defect rates, for example, to guarantee very tight tolerances on process parameters. Now, that is one of the challenges at the lowest level, but there's an opportunity right in there. Because now, if you look at a nanoscale fabric and say, well, this is a noisy communication channel. All right. So let's not work that hard and spend that much money working at the lowest level to make things deterministic. As opposed to that, let us take a systems perspective to this problem. Let us start by asking ourselves, can we embrace this non-determinism, and can we actually build reliable systems by leveraging Shannon's theory? All right. So there is a challenge and opportunity both at the lowest and the highest levels of this stack. So today, however, when we build systems, as I mentioned, we start bottom up. We rely on our friends, our colleagues in the device community to provide us with a ideal switch. And then with that switch, the rest of it follows, right? It's a bottom up driven trend when we move from one generation to the other. So today we are building, I would say, reliable systems with reliable components. That's how we build systems today. Now, what I'm going to talk about today is to turn this pyramid upside down and say that we should look at the work of Claude Shannon. You know, Claude Shannon was a mathematician who worked in Bell Labs in the 40s. And he really developed this model of mathematical basis for reliable communication over a noisy channel. That was his contribution. So why not we leverage his work, Shannon's work, and treat our nanoscale fabrics as noisy communication channels on which we want to build these inference-type machines, and then figure out ways to trade off robustness with energy efficiency and throughput and so on. So we are in a totally different universe once we change the perspective. Instead of looking at it bottom-up, if we change it and look at it top-down, then we might see things to be quite different. So if we did that, then we would be building reliable systems using unreliable components. So what is the Shannon universe looks like, right? So again, I'm a big fan of Shannon simply because when I first came across this work, I was totally taken aback by the notion that the information content, there's a difference between information content and the data, right? So we are all, when you design circuits, when you design chips, you're dealing with data. We are always dealing with bits and bytes and representations, right? And if you have a large volume of data, well, you need large storage. and that storage has to be extracted and processed, and decisions have to be made. This is how we think. But it turns out that that's just the form. The content of that data is captured in the distribution of those data bits. So if I have whatever the data file looks like, the frequency or the probability of occurrence of those data words is actually contributing to information. And that's really what we are after. The accuracy of your inference engine depends on that distribution much more than its form. Right? Form you can change, but the distribution is what is given to you. So one of the contributions, the major contribution of, by the way, this is a seminal paper, and we use the term seminal paper pretty freely these days, but Shannon's paper was indeed seminal because there was a time in history when communication systems before this paper were designed in one way. After this time, these systems were designed in a completely transformative way. And today, all communication systems we see out there are in fact designed using this paradigm. So what was his contribution? His contribution was, number one, he abstracted out the problem of communication into that very simple figure. It's an abstract representation of a communication channel. There's a message source, there's noise, and there is a receiver. And the goal of the system of designing this transmit and receiver is to ensure that the messages are transmitted reliably, that is, with probability of error approaching zero, even in presence of noise. And he established conditions under which this could be done. Right? He established limits on information transfer. That was one of the contributions of the paper. The second contribution was that he proved that he kind of hinted at the design technique to approach those bounds. So he said, well, there are good codes that I won't tell you what those are, but that you can go and find them. And those codes will actually bring you closer and closer to channel capacity. So those two things came out of his work. And it is highly analytical, mathematical. You can prove theorems, and you can build systems that approach those limits. So there's lots of, when you look at this work, you feel like, what? You know, that's really elegant. But when we build computing systems, it's all totally in a different universe. And why is there this gap between the two? So when you design chips, then you see that this gap becomes highly evident to you and makes you very uncomfortable. So in fact, these are some of the chips that I was involved with. So from the left side, those are the twisted pair wiring chips, the VDSL chips that I mentioned earlier. So these are 50 megabits, you know, VDSL, ATM LAN transceivers. And then when I came to Illinois, we designed, you know, LDPC decoders and turbo map decoders. So in each of these designs, the journey always started off at the highest level, at the algorithmic level, go down to the architecture level, and then go to the circuit level. Then you build it, you test it, you put it in a cable plant. In AT&T, we put these chips in a cable plant and look at the bit error rate and send real video data through the channel and see how it works. So during this journey, in the middle, when you talk about architectures, that's when there's a switch. We flip a switch. From the world of statistics, we go into the world of determinism, and then back to the world of statistics, right? So the question always bothered me, why do we have to have that switch? And it turned out that switch occurs simply because it helps us build complex systems. You can build, you know, you can scale up the complexity of your systems. You can build large scale systems in a very systematic way. So that's one of the benefits of having that switch. But the price we pay, I believe, is that we now have to deal with very large SNR circuit fabrics. And that in turn creates some sort of a power problem. Some energy problem arises because, you know, we have this transition from the world of statistics to determinism to statistics. And this feeling, this kind of conclusion was emphasized even more when in 2000, this was a startup company with my colleague Andy Singer. He's a faculty at University of Illinois working in the area of communications and signal processing. So we looked at the problem of data transmission in presence of dispersion, optical fiber dispersion. And in the early 2000s, there was kind of a feeling that, well, the problem is in the optical domain, so let's build optical PMD compensators and try to address it directly in the optical domain. So we came in here and said, no, well, you know what? We can use the power of statistical inference. We can use the power of communication theory to actually take the signal into the electrical domain and then process it. Now, today at 100G and beyond, having an ADC-based optical receiver is the standard way of doing things. But in those days, the receiver used to be a very simple clock data recovery circuit. If any compensation you had to do had to be done either in the optical domain or you do some sort of a forward error correction in the back end digital, right? So this journey, again, was very instructive. The channel was nonlinear. It's a non-coherent transmission scheme. There's a square law device, the photo detector. And so the receiver, we can use, so we propose the use of a nonlinear Viterbi equalizer. So that Viterbi equalizer has to operate at to process a data rate of 12.5 gigabits per second. So you have to kind of go back and reformulate the algorithm, come up with the architecture, and then implement it. And again, at the end, we are dealing with bit error rates, right? So this gap between what we do at the system level, what we do at the architectural level, was very evident. So that raises the question, how do we remove that transition? How do we make sure, is there any, first of all, value in thinking about processing information differently, about thinking about processing information in the Shannon style of data transmission? Is there any value to that? And if there is any value, how do we show it? What are the trade-offs and what are the pros and cons of this kind of perspective? So in the rest of my talk, in fact, this is the core of my talk, I will describe this, what I use the term statistical information processing rather than computing. Even though my title says computing, at the end of the day, I believe that modern day systems, even computing systems, are all about information processing, information extraction, information processing. This is where those are the kind of systems that we want to build. Of course, there is a, if it has to be a well-defined, if the Shannon-inspired perspective has to be applied in its fullest extent, then we should talk about limits. What is the limit of information processing over a noisy fabric? We should talk about that. We should talk about design techniques. Now, today I'll focus primarily on design techniques, but let me quickly share with you this, a short discussion about bounds and limits. So in fact, building systems using the Shannon perspective, building computing systems using Shannon perspective is not a new idea. It has been around, it has been kind of an ambition for a very long time. The 1956 paper that von Neumann wrote, in that that aspiration was indicated very clearly on the first page of this paper. And in fact, that paper led to a number of follow-on works by coding information theorists who came in and said, well, how do we build reliable logic networks with unreliable gates, right? So if I take a logic gate, assume that it makes errors, can I actually build a network whose network level reliability is greater than the component level reliability, right? So that was a question that he posed, von Neumann posed in that paper, and a number of works came out, including this work by Vinograd. You can see the motivation was exactly this, that the assumption in those days was it's not a good assumption to think that semiconductor components would be reliable, right? I'll say very shortly, I will say that that line of work provided two things. One, it provided bounds, and also provided some design techniques. But both of those results are negative. Negative in the sense that the bounds, in fact, the Shannon bound at the gate level is zero, right? The design techniques, which are constructions, logic level constructions, to make the network more reliable than the gate, those constructions are too expensive, so we don't use them, right? And in fact, the reason, so you might say, well, then it's end of story, why are we here? The reason that those results are negative is because of this focus at the gate level. And in fact, one of the authors, Peter Elias, was a very famous coding theorist and who did work in this particular area. One of his contributions was in this area. He did speculate and say that, well, maybe our problem definition is not right. Maybe we shouldn't be focusing, we shouldn't be thinking about computing as a collection of gates. And in fact, what I'll tell you today, what I'll describe today is that we are not looking at gates per se. We have escalated the level of abstraction. We are looking at systems. You look at a system and then look at the information flow through that system, figure out ways to maximize that information flow in presence of noise, right? So once you go up to the architecture and system level, then the landscape changes quite a bit completely. You can talk about bounds, but I think it's much more interesting to talk about design techniques and see how those design techniques change or differ. So that brings me to the definition. At least this definition is evolving, but this is how it looks right now to me. Based on everything we have done so far in the past, there are three components in a Shannon-inspired information processing universe. The first component is an understanding of what the user needs. So when you are at today, when you are at the logic level, you're kind of decoupled from what the application level requirements are. So that decoupling has to be removed. And in fact, when we design communication chips, that decoupling is not there. We actually couple our understanding of systems to architectures to circuits very well. So this is simply saying, you know, look at the metrics by which your system will be evaluated. When you design a component, it has to be designed in the context of the entire system, not in isolation. Second is we need, of course, Shannon theory comes in and it becomes applicable when the circuit fabric is unreliable. If the circuit fabric is deterministic, then I have nothing to say. We don't have anything to do here. We can deal with, you know, the traditional path and all those innovations that are currently occurring in the deterministic von Neumann style of computing, right? We can do that. But we need a circuit fabric where, for whatever reason, maybe it's reasons of efficiency, energy efficiency, maybe it is reasons for throughput efficiency, we have this trade-off between robustness and efficiency. So we need a fabric in which we implement, let's say, this block C that needs to be implemented, that consumes maybe 80 to 95% of the total complexity of this stochastic fabric, the fabric that is unreliable, right? Now, because it is unreliable, the outputs of this block are unacceptable. They don't meet the requirements, the system level requirements. So I throw in a third component, the third and the last component, which is a component that treats the block C as a communication channel, and it leverages techniques from the Shannon universe, techniques of estimation, detection, statistical techniques for estimation and detection, which today are utilized in all our communication receivers to infer what was transmitted. All right, so we have channel estimation techniques, we use those. We have equalization techniques, error control techniques, diversity techniques to enhance the robustness of our receiver. So all of those techniques, we have to somehow figure out ways to make them low complexity and then process the outputs of the block C that we want to design. Block C is what we want to implement, and we want to implement in a non-deterministic manner because we want some sort of a efficiency benefit, okay? So these are the three components. What I'll do next, yes.
It seems to me there's a fourth component, namely the arbiter, which introduces indeterminacy into these systems, not just unreliability.
So I would put that in the second bucket. I would say that it is coming in from, so is that not what you're talking about? No.
No, there's a circuit called an arbiter. Are you familiar with this circuit?
I've heard about it, yeah.
Okay. It's used in internal arbitration inside.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it makes decisions without making choices.
You're right. So arbiter is a decision maker. And this estimator detector is playing the role of the arbiter because it is making the final corrected output is the decision that this particular processing unit produces.
Yeah. And really, that's a combinational circuit of some kind. It's not an arbiter. In the technical sense of arbiter.
I think of the estimator detector as a kind of a receiver. It's an inference engine, and it's trying to figure out what the correct output was. So it has to make a decision. You can call it arbiter.
An arbiter is like an umpire. When I say he's out, he's out.
Right.
He's not estimating anything. He's not detecting anything.
Yeah.
He's making the decision.
Here, the decision maker.
Okay, but go on.
Let's take this offline.
I think in the computing community, we use the term arbiter. But coming from the communication side, there is a slicer that makes decisions. There is a decoder that makes decisions. And those decisions are made on the transmitted information. So in that sense, it's similar. It's coming to that point. Let's take it offline. Yeah. All right. So in order to build these kind of systems, you know, in a systematic, principled way, we need certain models. Right? We need models of how errors are occurring, what kind of errors are occurring in the circuit fabric. So this is what we have proposed in the past. It's not the end of the story. There are many possible variations. But we look at noisy computation as having this three steps, or rather these different components. You have an output, which is an error-free output that you're after. So C0 is the error-free implementation of your computation. But what happens in reality is you see Y, which is the observed output. And that Y is different from Y0 through the presence of a hardware error, right? So maybe that, so nanoscale hardware errors are making Y different from Y0. It could be additive, I'm showing additive model here, could be any other model. So eta is coming in, and E is estimation error, approximation error. Because when you're in the world of statistical inference, approximations, estimations are very common. And you may want to implement an approximate version. You may want to use that approximate version for error compensation. There are many, many uses of thinking about information processing or inference kernels in this way. So in this model, then, X, eta, and E are all random processes, right? So they're all statistical in nature. And what we would like to do is look at Y. So we don't have access to Y0. We want to look at Y. We may have some knowledge about the statistics of eta and E, okay? We don't know what is eta and E, but we have some knowledge of their statistics. We want to account for those, and maybe in some cases, the statistics of X, right? If necessary. And then we want to fix it. We want to go from Y, the erroneous output, to Y hat, the corrected output, okay? So in the estimator and detector then, we may take the probability mass functions, the probability distribution functions of eta and E, maybe the joint distribution, maybe the marginals, whatever it is. We want to either explicitly use it, that is actually characterize the circuit fabric, get the error PMFs, use it as an input into the error compensator, or we may use them in implicit ways. That is, we make some assumptions that maybe the distributions look like this. Maybe one is Gaussian, one is non-Gaussian, and then we exploit that difference for error compensation. And I'll give an example later of this this form of estimation and detection.
Your use of the term corrected seems a little strange. Don't you mean expected? It's a statistical value that is possibly wrong.
Right, right. So
the question was the use of correction may not be appropriate here. And in fact, we use the term compensation for this reason.
Okay.
So it is, if your system level metric is something like the quality of an image or the signal to noise ratio, you want to hit that, right? You want to come and hit those numbers. But individual values may be actually off.
And you also have equivalent of a variance for this particular value?
Yes, okay. Yes, yeah. So let's put all of this together. I'll take a case study where we'll address all of these questions. So over the years, we have these four kind of very broad classes of error compensation techniques or Shannon-inspired techniques. The one on the left is the one that I will delve deeper because we used it in that case study I mentioned earlier. And the others are, in fact, we do also have an integrated circuit implementation of the stochastic sensor network on a chip, SSNOC formulation. In all cases, you'll notice that there are some blocks. In fact, I should have put some, like the blue blocks are the ones that are making errors, and they're supposed to be large. That 80, 95% of the chip that I mentioned are actually those blue boxes. The others are the extra. Estimator detection block are those the non-blue boxes that are trying to figure out what the right answer is. In SSNOC, in fact, all the boxes. So, for example, in algorithmic noise tolerance, we might say that let's implement block B. Okay, it's 80-90% of the chip, but then I need an estimator to go along with it. I need that comparator. I need a mux and so on and so forth. In SSNOC, we just focus on using only estimators, right? So I'll give an example of this in a while. So what is the status of this kind of work? In fact, we have taken this journey from principles to architectures to circuits a few times, right? So that journey has been taken. I would like to take many more such journeys. I would, in fact, like to figure out a way to make it more systematic so that others can also traverse this path. So the principles I showed you in the previous slide, each of those could be taken. You could map it to architectures and then implement chips in which the circuit fabric is permitted to make errors at a very high rate. And then you have these compensators that are sitting in there correcting for those errors. All right. And you get, in fact, this Shannon-inspired perspective, the error compensation that you can achieve, the degree of errors, hardware errors that you can handle are orders of magnitude higher than the traditional, NMR or replay type of error compensation. Okay, to achieve the same SNR, the same bit error rate, you can actually let the circuit fabric make errors at a very high rate. Yeah.
Mark. So far in this talk, you've been telling us about the advantages of this way of thinking. Yeah. If you haven't explained to me any of these, what is this way of thinking? That is, because in the model that you said, the errors are some additive process to the output.
Yeah.
The problem with logic is a completely nonlinear process. If you put noise in that process, you destroy information in highly uncorrelated and hard to predict ways from the output, depending on what noise is injected into the logic.
So,
it would be very helpful for me in order to understand this point.
Yes.
To understand what's the basic principle that I would use to try
okay,
to.
Okay, good question. Yeah. Good question. That's precisely why I have this case study right coming up,
okay,
in which we will look at how this model comes in. And very quick answer to your question. Your question was at the logic level. So this is not a logic level technique. At the end of the day, that block C, I don't view it as a logic block, even though it may be a logic block. But the representation of the signals, I'm not looking at, if it is an 8-bit signal, I view 8-bit value that comes out of a block. I view that as a sample of a signal, all right? So it requires some interpretation of, in a system context, in an application context, what does that 8-bit number mean? Once you have that, then rest of it follows. That's a very short answer.
Okay. Yeah.
So, case study, all right? So this is a chip that we had designed. It was, this is my student, Rami Abdullah. He finished this work. It's a ECG processor. An ECG processor, its job is to, in fact, take an ECG signal and classify it as normal or abnormal. So this paper was published in Journal of Solid State Circuits in last year, November. So for details, you can look at it. I'll pull out certain key aspects of this work and share it with you. So what does this processor need to do? What are the system requirements? Remember, that's the first component. What are the system requirements? Well, of course, there are some limits or certain specifications on the input signal. There are, of course, many algorithms for ECG classification. This is one of those, okay? It is a unsupervised ECG classification algorithm. All it is doing is that there are a bunch of signal processing stages in the front that are extracting certain features from that waveform. And then there's the final stage, which is your peak detector that is doing the classification. And that's typical of most inference kernel. You have a feature extraction stage, then you have a classification stage, and you may have cascades of these kind of blocks throughout the chain. Now, so the output of this entire chain is binary, normal or abnormal. Second, the application metrics are statistical in nature. So for example, sensitivity. So that ECG processor, it should have high sensitivity, meaning that if a patient is sick, then if the test is true, right, the test that is done on the patient, conditioned on the fact that you have a sick population, that test should indicate that the person, that particular patient is sick with a very high probability, right? So that's the sensitivity. Similarly, positivity you can define. Right? All of those are ratios of the number of true positives, number of false negatives, and so on and so forth. You can take those ratios, you can measure it. if you have statistical models of the output, you can in fact analyze it and predict it using detection theory. Okay. So so that was the first component. The second component is we want a circuit fabric in which I said a trade-off between energy efficiency or throughput efficiency and robustness needs to be there. Now, with CMOS, CMOS is actually a very deterministic and a pretty reliable substrate. So what we have done, and I'm not saying this is the best possible way to make that trade-off, but what we have done is we have taken a technique called, we proposed a technique called voltage overscaling. So voltage scaling, we all know, when you reduce the supply voltage, you reduce the clock frequency to avoid errors. So what if you don't reduce the clock frequency, but you reduce the supply voltage, right? You'll get timing violations. Now, that's a regime in which we don't want our circuits to operate because you get errors. But here, suppose I have a very powerful technique to handle those errors, then I may want to play in this domain. So voltage overscaling is essentially you reduce, as I mentioned, you can plot the error rate. This is for a, I guess, four-tap correlation filter. This is all simulation results, by the way. So this is on this axis, we see the probability of error, and this is the supply voltage. And the frequency is kind of fixed at a particular value. You'll see that the error rate starts to increase immediately, quite fast, as the supply voltage is reduced beyond the critical value. But also your energy efficiency starts to improve, right? So energy efficiency goes up, but at the expense of error rate. So for example, you have 9x, factor of 9x savings in energy, provided you can handle a raw error rate of 60%, which is a very high error rate. So what does 60% mean? It means 60% of the clock cycles are in error. Okay, 60% of the clock cycles, I have at least one bit in error somewhere on the chip. It may be many more bits, maybe all the bits are in error. I still count it as one error, all right? So that's actually the error rate. When I use the term raw error rate, this is what I mean. Okay, the third component is, how do I address it? How do I address this error rate? Yeah, Shriram.
Timing violation, you can try some shift-lock into meta-stability, and that can cause many cycles of error.
Right.
It's going back to the non-linear effect right. of these things. So, do you have to make this logic resistant to metastability?
So question was, how do you handle metastability when you play with supply voltage and clock frequency, right? So in here, we have not done anything to the logic. In fact, the chip that I'm going to talk about is a standard synthesized chip. Now, can we do better? We can do better. But the goal here was to say, well, let's not play too much at the circuit level. Let's take what we get. Let's reduce the supply voltage, keep the clock frequency fixed, and see what kind of errors occur and whether we can compensate for it. But as you'll see that in future, I think we should pay attention to what's going on down there so that we get a much better trade-off between energy and robustness. So algorithmic noise tolerance is one of those four classes of techniques I described earlier. How does it work? Well, there is this main block, that ECG processor I showed you. That's the block, that's the blue block I want to implement. But because it is voltage overscaled, I get those errors eta, all right? So again, coming back to Mark's question, the output, why not, right? Why not is essentially the output of the signal, the final block in the signal processing chain, right? And it is treated as a signal. It is a random process, it is a signal. And it has a correct value, which is why not, but because of timing violations, it is perturbed. What I really observe is y sub a, the actual value. Now, if I can figure out an estimator of the main block, an estimator is an approximate version of the main block, okay? So it's going to give me an output, which is also erroneous, but in a different way. It's going to give me an output y not plus e, where e is the estimation error. And it turns out that if the statistics of eta and the statistics of e, that is the hardware error coming out of the main block, and the statistics of estimation error coming out of the estimator, if they are significantly different, then a very simple error compensation scheme works quite well, right? And that scheme is simply to compare the outputs of the two blocks and see if it is greater than a threshold. If it is greater, then you're saying, well, you know, I think that the main block has made an error. because timing violations will make the main block generate MSB errors, which are quite large, right? So MSB errors are generally bad, but here they are good because they help you detect errors, okay? So error detection is facilitated by having a large errors when they occur to have them large in the main block. And the correction is simple. You assume that at that moment, the estimator is in fact not making an error. In fact, because the estimator, the estimation errors are more Gaussian-like, most likely the estimation error at that point is a small valued error. So you have a choice between a large valued error on the main block output versus a small valued error on the estimator output, and you choose the second one. Yeah. So
is this applicable for the blocks other than filter?
Sorry?
Like which blocks we can do this technique? Is it just a filter or?
Good question. Question is, what sort of blocks are amenable to this kind of these kind of techniques, right? So I would say any block in which the metric that you're interested in evaluating. So here, for example, in case of ECG processor, what we want is the output to have a very high signal to noise ratio, right? So that when we make a decision, then the quality of the decision is quite good. So as long as you have that kind of a metric in place, then you can interpret the output of such a block as a signal corrupted by noise, and then use this kind of approach, right? So here we have used a filter, but there are other blocks that you can try them out on. All right, so what we find here is
the estimator is implemented in the same fabric as the main block.
Yes.
So if I assume the main block is doing errors, why should the estimator not make errors?
So good question. So the estimator, in fact, if you noticed, the estimator is designed to be small, right? I said roughly maybe 5 to 10, maybe 20% of the total complexity. And because it is small, in this particular work, we assume that in ANT, algorithmic noise tolerance, we assume that the estimator, we make it worst case. We design it for the worst case. We ensure that it does not make hardware errors, right? So we focus on a small part of the entire system and make it, I would say, deterministic in that sense, right? It still has estimation errors, but there are no hardware errors for the estimator. Now, that's true for algorithmic noise tolerance. For stochastic sensor network on a chip, what I just said is not true. In fact, all of those blocks are estimators, which are also, let's say, subject to hardware errors. So all of them will have two kinds of noise, eta and e. And therefore, the error compensation technique that we use will be quite different, right? So here we are kind of making majority of the circuit either voltage overscaled or implemented on a stochastic fabric, allowing it to make errors. And a small part of it, smaller the better. You know, 5% overhead would be ideal if you can get to it.
Are you adding or subtracting?
Sorry?
Are you adding the signals here or subtracting?
Subtract, yes.
Okay. So the question was, am I adding or subtracting? Actually, I'm taking the difference, YA minus YE. I'm taking the difference of the two signals. So, okay. So in most cases, both of them are not making errors, the difference will be small. And if the main block makes errors, then most likely, again, these are all statistical quantities. You can analyze it. You can predict, you know, what is the detection accuracy and what is the SNR and so on. Yeah.
We assume the estimator is always right. Why don't we take always that out?
Good question. So if the estimator is always right, then why not just use the estimator, right? Actually, the estimator is not always right. It has estimation errors. So in fact, this inequality here answers your question directly. The uncompensated SNR, which is the SNR at the output of the main block, is actually is much worse than the desired SNR. It's much smaller than that because you have MSB errors, which are infrequent, but when they occur, they are very large magnitude, right? The estimator SNR is also much worse than SNR naught. Why? Because the errors are very frequent, but they're small magnitude. Okay, but when you ping pong between them, you have this overall SNR at the output, which is still worse than SNR naught, but the difference is small. And you can make that difference as small as you want by playing around with the complexity of the estimator, the error rate of the main block, and so on and so forth. Okay. So yes, we want to start with a block that is just meeting your performance requirements, right? I mean, that's what we want to. We don't want to have the estimator be as good as an error-free main block. Okay, so there are a number of algorithmic noise tolerance techniques that have come up. Some of them take the prediction-based. All right, you take the output of the block B, and you leverage the correlation between temporal correlation between the samples at the output of block B to predict the correct output. So here, the estimator is a predictor, and the predictor is taking the outputs of the block B. Reduced precision replica, probably the simplest conceptually to understand how it works. The estimator is simply a reduced precision version of the block B. So now the estimation error is quantization noise, right? And you can predict what that quantization noise would look like. And so you can set that threshold and kind of build a very nice reduced precision replica based AND technique. And there are a few other techniques. You can, for example, take the inputs, downsample it for the estimator. So the estimator is working on a reduced data set. So its output won't be as accurate as the main block, which is working on the full data set, right? So it's going to make errors in a different way. All right, so coming back to the ECG processor, what is used here is the reduced precision estimator. Again, it's a very standard architecture with its pipeline, bunch of muxes all over the place, so you can bypass controllability and observability placed in there. Overhead in this case, you know, we didn't pay too much attention, but overhead turned out to be 30%. That is, all the extras that were put in consumed about 30% of the total complexity. This is a 45 nanometer design, purely synthesized, measured results. So the first thing you want to do is characterize it. When the circuit fabric is stochastic, what are the error rates? How does it depend on supply voltage and so on? So we start off by putting that circuit in at its minimum energy operating point. That is at the point where your dynamic and leakage energies get balanced. And we call it MEOP, minimum energy operating point. And you do two things. One, either you voltage overscale, meaning you reduce the voltage and see how the error rate goes up, or you keep the voltage fixed and increase the frequency and see how the error rate goes up. And you'll see in both cases, on the y-axis, I have the percentage errors, that is percentage of clock cycles making errors. And you see that voltage overscaling is, in fact, you know, its error rate is very sensitive to voltage. And we know that because delay is very sensitive to voltage in that near threshold or sub-threshold regime. So that's simply characterization of the circuit fabric. Then another question we had was, well, we always deal with error PMFs. In simulations, I want to figure out the error PMF, use that for analysis, system analysis. How real is that error PMF? How closely is it correlated with what I observe in practice? And it turned out for this particular, it was a part of one of the stages, the measured error PMF, simulated error PMF, they're not exactly the same, but you know, they are pretty similar in nature. And that gives us confidence that the methodology we have for design, that is, before we even design the integrated circuit, you know, we have this methodology for extracting error PMF from the architecture. That methodology can be relied upon. That is, we can use that for predicting system behavior. Robustness, third set of results. So this one shows how the bottom two curves are the, so on the y-axis, I have detection accuracy. Higher the better. The moment, the x-axis tells me the raw error rate of the circuit fabric. So zero means it is deterministic, so everyone is doing well. But as soon as the error rate starts to increase, the conventional uncorrected systems, their detection accuracy starts to drop dramatically. All right, so it drops catastrophically. Whereas with algorithmic noise tolerance techniques, you're kind of holding on to the detection accuracy until you reach about 58% error rate, and then it starts to drop. Right? So now this number 58% is for this design. You can play around with it and either increase it or reduce it. Maybe the complexity of your estimator has to go up to make that number even better. But it's a pretty rich design space, and you can come up with many, many different trade-offs. The right-hand side shows the histogram of the R to R interval, that is the beat frequency, right, that this particular processor detects. And you can see that in the conventional case, your beat frequency should be somewhere here. 1/heart rate should be about 1 second. And that's actually spread out because of errors, right? The errors spread it out. But with AND-based systems, they're kind of squeezed in and you're back to what you expect. I'll skip these two slides. We are kind of running out of time, so I'll skip these results. There are a few other Shannon-inspired work that I want to talk about. One of them is, I mentioned earlier, stochastic sensor network on a chip. This is also a journey from systems to architectures to circuits. Here, the assumption, the technique is to take a computation and then replace it. The block B, or the main block, is replaced by a bunch of estimators. So each estimator on its own cannot give you the right performance you're looking for, but those estimators are designed to create errors in some sort of an uncorrelated fashion. And then you fuse the outputs to get the final high quality output of this block, right? And again, this was a 256 tap PN acquisition, a PN code acquisition filter that was implemented in 180 nanometer. And again, you get, you know, significant energy savings while handling raw error rates that are in tens of percentage points. So here it's about 86% error. This is an old work, I'll skip. ADCs. So can we use some of these information-based ideas for analog circuits? So in fact, the inter-symbol experience I mentioned earlier, the ADC turned out to be the bottleneck. You know, you needed 4 bits operating at 12.5 gigasample per second, and that was actually very hard to do. But if you realize that at the end of the day, the equalizer output has to give you a bit error rate of 10 to the power minus 3 or 10 to the power minus 4, because there is FEC that follows it, then you may think about the A2D design differently. So here, if it, A2Ds today are designed to be waveform preservers, right? You, the metrics of A2D design are signal to noise plus distortion ratio, ultimately ENOB, effective number of bits. Well, what does that mean? That simply means that if I send in a sine wave at the input to an A2D converter, take its output, what is the fidelity of that digital representation? But in a communication link, fidelity is an overkill. Fidelity of the waveforms are an overkill. What we are interested in is the information that is embedded in that waveform. So instead of putting the reference levels uniformly agnostic to the quality of the statistics of the input signal, if you instead looked at the probability distribution of the signal and set the reference levels accordingly, then you can actually shave off. In this case, you can show that a 3-bit A2D converter, BER optimal A2D converter, gives you much better BER than a 4-bit conventional uniformly spaced reference levels A2D converter. All right? Why is it? Because those reference levels are set at the decision points, at the points where the information content of the input signal is captured. Now, the ENOB of this 3-bit A2D converter is terrible. It's in fact worse than the 3-bit uniform A2D converter. But in terms of BER, it is fantastic. Okay, it gives you orders of magnitude better BER at a specific SNR.
So this is matching the mutual information.
Yes, yes, that's right. So you want to maximize, instead of using SNDR type metrics, we want to use mutual information type metrics, right?
But that depends on the sine wave going in. Sorry? Is that depending on the sine wave going in?
If I feel it depends on the statistics of the signal, yes. So are you, you know, is, where is the information residing in your received signal? What is the probability distribution of your received signal? And what you want to do is maximize the information content at the output of the A2D, you know, given your transmitted information, transmitted bit. So the mutual information, as you were mentioning, between the transmitted bit and the output of the A2D, if you maximize that, you get a very different kind of A2D converter, right? Okay. So I want to just step back quickly, and I'm running out of time here. So in 2013, we have established a new center called SONIC, Systems on Nanoscale Information Fabrics. And again, the focus of this center is really to take it's really very expanded, taking this notion of Shannon-inspiredness, bringing in brain-inspired ideas, connecting systems to architectures to circuits and devices, CMOS and beyond CMOS devices. So this center is funded under the StarNet program. And Andy Singer, I mentioned his name earlier, he's the associate director. In fact, Stanford has, I think, about five faculty members who are members of SONIC. Boris is leading one of the research teams in SONIC. Philip Wong is leading another research team. Then we have Subhashish Mitra, Amin, and Eric Pop representing Stanford in this particular center. So you'll notice in this team, we have neuroscientists, we have information coding theorists, and we have circuit designers. In fact, a very strong bench of circuit designers and device researchers. Why? Because we want to take the journey from systems, applications, to architectures, to circuits and devices. And hopefully we can flesh it out and systematize this particular way of thinking about information processing. You can take a look at the website. It's www.sonicscenter.org. The research themes, two of them are Shannon-Inspired, three systems themes and one device theme. Two of the themes, theme one and theme two, are Shannon and or communication inspired. Theme three is cognitive, brain inspired. And then the activities in the center have, you know, bottom up and top down flow. That is, we look at principles. Algorithmic noise tolerance is one example, but there are many, many principles you can explore from the world of neuroscience, from the world of communications. Look at architectures for inference kernels. Build prototypes in CMOS. And then bottom up, we look at new devices, working with our device centers, LEAST, C-SPIN, and FAME, building nano primitives, nano functions, and moving up. Future, you know, this whole area is quite rich in terms of circuit. We look at circuits now differently. We can let circuit make errors, but what kind of errors and what's that trade-off? How do you get efficient trade-offs? What is a low SNR circuit fabric that I want to build in which energy efficiency is maximized, but error rates are such that they can be compensated for? What are different error compensation schemes? Some of them may be based on machine learning techniques. What are new applications that are emerging? In fact, a lot of those applications I list here, Internet of Things, autonomous systems, all of these require this information extraction from data at the end of the day. And lastly, in an embedded platform, you have to worry about not just information processing, but also energy processing. So can we combine the two? So I'll, how much time do I have for this? Right? Okay, I'll just point out.
We have until 10 minutes or two.
Well, we have about 15 minutes.
I take five minutes.
15 minutes, easily.
All right, I'll take just five minutes or so. So this is one
example of a project in SONIC where we're looking at a machine learning application, and we are showing that in presence of errors, a lot of these inference kernels are intrinsically robust, right? You don't have to do much. But if you now push the limits of the robustness, then you can bring in those Shannon-inspired techniques to compensate for errors. So there are like two levels of robustness that you can explore. Low SNR circuit fabric. Well, now, if you're confident that we can actually compensate for errors, then you can be a lot more adventurous with your circuits. So this is an example where we said, well, what if I build a memory array in which I read the data, but not just to read the data and bring it out into the full swing domain, but actually to do some computations inside it, analog computations. Because why? At the end of the day, I want this memory unit to give me a decision. You know, yes, maybe it's an ECG processor. I want you to tell me yes or no. And the ECG signal is sitting inside it, right? Is it normal or abnormal? Well, turns out if you store the data in this column-wise fashion, then you can treat the read process as a multi-bit D2A converter. So now your bit lines are not storing information about one bit, but it's storing information about multiple bits. So it has a number of benefits in terms of reducing the energy consumption. It is exploiting the intrinsic low SNR property of a memory array to reduce energy. And it's exploiting the fact that this is an inference kernel so that, you know, the notion of correctness is quite relaxed. So we are targeting a tape out in 28 nanometer next semester. This is a project that just completed where we integrated computation inside a switch cap voltage regulator. So basically the power switches were replaced by compute switches. Because at the end of the day, power switches are transferring charge. Compute switches are processing information also by transferring charge. So this particular design kind of combines the two functions into one and provides overall system level efficiency. So finally, this is my last slide. The key takeaways here is that when we think about Shannon-inspired information processing, it is meant to make the design of these computing systems of the future principled, being able to embrace statistics of the circuit fabric in a principled way to predict performances and really to design these inference-based systems of the future. There are a number of opportunities for system researchers. If you have a strong background in statistical signal processing, estimation, detection, communications, machine learning, well, there's a lot of room there to come in and contribute to this area. Architecturally, same thing. We can actually take some of these cores I just talked about and stitch them together into a stochastic system on a chip, right? So you have one deterministic core that's farming out the tasks, and then the tasks themselves are being executed on this accelerator cores that may be using Shannon-inspired techniques. So that's one way by which we might be able to build a more general platform for using this these type of ideas. Of course, the holy grail would be a truly Shannon-inspired information processor, where we compose a new processor architecture using these principles. This is still a speculation. I don't know how to do that. You know, it's still out there that we all need to think about. The last one is, of course, thinking about circuits and devices in a different way, right? How do I design low SNR circuit fabrics? How do I trade off energy efficiency, robustness? How do I engineer the error statistics so that the circuit fabric fits into this paradigm? So with that, I'll stop and see if there are any more questions.
Yeah.
Is it that the Shannon-inspired techniques apply mainly to data paths because they have control-oriented represents like that? Then you can have very unpredictable error. You can go to some unknown state and maybe lock up, in which case you get nothing.
Yeah.
So I would say it's much more amenable to data processing. In fact, if you take a standard von Neumann architecture and then let that make errors and then try to protect it, then you will run into this problem that the control path errors will be catastrophic. So you want to protect it. In fact, Sharad Malik has a project in Sonic where he's addressing this question directly. But it is much more difficult than data processing or data paths. Sorry?
Razor
is from Michigan, yes. So that is, in fact, the philosophy there is also you make errors, but when you detect it at the logic level, and then there is a kind of a replay. The cost of error compensation in Razor is very high. But they do present a deterministic fabric to the application. So that's the advantage,
so
and they're general.
Used for control, right?
They can be used, yes. Yeah. Well. Yes.
So what's the model of signals in this kind of a system? They're basically a stream of bit vectors, I would assume. But once you've decided that you're going to depend upon statistics and make an estimation, now you have a estimated signal plus some additional statistical information which at least none of the diagrams you showed actually utilized, but the statistics of the incoming data are going to be used, or the inputs are going to be the outputs of previous statistical processes. And those have a statistics all of their own, which is different than the statistics of the original signal, and yet you have not really, it seems to me, thought through how you're going to use this, that statistical information at the next level of abstraction.
Right. So if I got your question correctly, I think you're talking about how to compose
yes.
a more complex system,
yes.
right, using these kind of concepts. So right now what we have is you have a function you want to implement, and that function has to process certain input signals. The input signal has some statistics. The circuit fabric, the nanoscale fabric, has certain error statistics, right?
It assumes certain error statistics.
Yeah, well, you can actually calibrate it, right? You can actually measure it in when you power up the chip, you can actually send in known signals in and go through some sort of a calibration step to extract the error statistics and then use it. But right now in the design I showed you, it uses error statistics in an implicit way. Mm-hmm. It doesn't do explicit characterization because, I mean, that technique doesn't need it. ANT doesn't need it. It just relies on the fact that hardware errors and estimation errors are way different from each other. But there are other techniques, which I didn't talk about, where the error PMFs are actually used for error compensation. So there you need to do some sort of a, you know, circuit characterization to extract those.
Okay, we'll take it offline.
Yeah.
Anybody else? Question?
Yeah, when you were speaking, I thought of Bernie Widrow and the
yes.
noise echo cancellation circuit that he did here at Stanford.
Yes.
Because, so that's a, you know, communication wire.
Yes.
And a lot of noise on it, and you take the noise out of it. Except for now it's like on a chip or something.
Yeah, yeah. So actually Bernie Widrow's work, LMS, least mean square algorithm, it's an adaptive signal processing algorithm, which is very, very mainstream adaptive algorithm used today. And it again utilizes a statistical model for the signal. But it is for the signal that comes out of the channel or the signal that is observed from the environment. But because it leverages this statistical framework, it can learn the model of the input signal and then give you what that model looks like. So in a receiver, for example, I can use that technique, LMS technique, to either model the channel through a channel estimator, or I can use the same technique to cancel a near-end crosstalk or echo, or I can use the same technique for equalization, right? So these are all, it's a learning technique. It learns the statistics of your input signal, and once you know that, then you do something with it. In fact, in a communication receiver, you use that knowledge to recover the transmitted data.
This chip design, you not learn, you know, or have already modeled?
Actually, in here, you want to learn the statistics of the hardware errors, for example, right? So now the notion of the channel has expanded into the circuit itself. So there's noise in the channel, there's noise in the circuit, and you can use learning algorithms to extract those statistics and then use it for compensation. It's related.
One other question. Yeah. Nothing ever happens unless someone does it. As you're talking, especially about statistics, I ran into Lapizada at one time in my career, and fuzzy logic, and it's like, well, you can do this, but you can do it a whole lot quicker because you're not trying to be so accurate or something.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What is the best bit error rates or signal noise rates you've ever dealt with?
Best? You mean the highest?
Right.
So I guess serial links have a very high SNR. Optical links, DSL, they are kind of normal communication links.
I mean a quantity.
Oh, quantity. So the SNRs that typically we deal with can be anywhere from a few, you know, maybe 10 dB, a few dBs to maybe 20, 30, 40 dB of that sort, in that range.
Bit error rates?
If it is a, you know, FEC-based link, then the bit error rates vary from 10 to the power minus 3 to 10 to the power minus 6. But in some designs, you know, you may use a very weak FEC, then the bit error rate needs to be even lower. So 10 to the power, in fact, for 10 to the power minus 12 or smaller is pretty common for chip-to-chip links.
Okay.
But in a regular, you know, twisted pair channel, there the bit rates are generally higher at the output of the equalizer. After the error control decoder, again, it has to be quite low. Yeah.
What's the connection between the brain-inspired and the Shannon-inspired computing, since you're center group them?
Good question. So in the beginning, it seems like they are two different. So the question was, what's the difference between brain-inspired and Shannon-inspired? At first glance, it seems they're very different. But before I get into that, in brain-inspired computing, there are many different ways of looking at it. In the center, we tend to look at building brain-inspired systems by first understanding how the brain processes and stores information, right? Then mapping them to architectures and circuits. This is a bit different from looking at the brain structurally, trying to emulate it in circuit fabrics. That's neuromorphic path. Ours is more of a neuro-principled or neuro-inspired approach. It's more top-down. Now, if you take this top-down perspective, then again, the jury is still out. What is the right model? It's still being debated in the world of neuroscience. There are some models that are, you know, that are thought to be good models. And one of those is the idea of signal representation. So in the brain, it is hypothesized that signals are mapped into a very high dimensional space to provide robustness. And also, it is very sparse, and that makes it more efficient. So when you go into this high-dimensional space and very sparse space, then that is actually akin. That's very similar to the random coding argument that Shannon used in his 1948 paper for proving the channel capacity theorem. So there he showed that if you take block length, a random code is a very good code, was part of his proof. But it was never meant to be used as a design technique, because in communication receivers, you can't have, you know, very high mapping, a dimensional, you always try to minimize the code rate, right? I mean, you maximize the code rate, K over N, you try to maximize it. So you're always putting small amounts of redundancy to get max error compensation. But the proof is actually going for exponentially, you know, infinitely long block lengths. Now, the brain actually is doing something different. It is computing. It is actually trying to make some decisions. So there's no transmitter sitting there trying to encode things for you. It is, information is embedded in the natural world and is trying to make a decision. So there, the prediction is that hyperdimensional signal representation actually can help you build energy efficient circuits and systems, right? And you can compute with in that particular space. So that is that's the link between the two. The other link between the two is that in both cases, we know that, you know, one is a, you know, human engineered system, one is a naturally engineered system. In both cases, robust system behavior is provided with unreliable components. In case of communication, the unreliability comes from the channel. In case of the brain, it's the substrate that is unreliable.
Thanks.
Yes.
A lot of this is very non-intuitive. I'm getting hung up on trying to find a real-world example of what that functional block might be. Something as simple as just a multiplier, where the failure mode might be that one of the input bits might get flipped. Then the output could be, there's only one right answer, there's an infinite number, practically, of wrong answers, depending on which bit flips. The answer might be right, or it might be just a little bit wrong, or a medium amount wrong, or a huge amount wrong. Your estimator has an approximation, and for many of the possible errors, they can't possibly be so different that the estimator will be able to figure out something happened. So if you could have an error, you could have an answer which is wrong, but close enough that the estimator can't tell that it's wrong, and therefore the wrong answer will propagate onto the rest of the system. If it was okay that it simply be within the range of the estimator, why not simply use that as the... I'm having trouble finding a real-world application that could use these techniques.
Yeah, so that's why in the technique that I described, when the main multiplier, if you want to think about... By the way, I don't want to think in terms of building a multiplier. Think in terms of a receiver or a equalizer, right? At that level, we want to be. But let's take the example of the multiplier. At that level, for this technique to work, the technique that I described, the multiplier, when it makes errors, I said it has to make a big, dramatic, you know, MSB errors. So why am I doing that? It's because for exactly that reason, I wanted to move into a regime which is unacceptable, but at the same time, it is detectable, right? So for this particular technique, I want that. Now, the other one is where you take that big multiplier, and maybe there's a way to partition it into smaller ones. When you make it smaller, you're always getting some error because those are estimation errors. They'll never be exact. Now, if those errors are uncorrelated to each other, then I can combine it to enhance the quality of the output. When I say enhancement, it is not perfect. It won't give you the correct output, but it'll be pretty close to the correct output. At the multiplier level, you might say, well, that's still a wrong multiplier. But I argue that that multiplier is part of a larger system, and you want to ask the question, is the system able to absorb it? So that's why we have to move from logic up to the system level. Then we can talk about these things very well.
How do you define the metric for correct?
The qualification of the chips is a hard problem, right?
Because there are many. So the question was, what is the definition of correctness? It cannot be, it can't be the traditional definitions because, in fact, we are making errors all the time, right? At the end of the day, I'm using a metric such as bit error rate in which I'm expecting I'll be getting errors all the time, right? But then when I build the architecture today, then I have artificially said, if I get these set of inputs, I can only get those set of outputs. And that's my definition of correctness. But instead, if you said that for a given input, there's a class of acceptable outputs, because for that class, my system level metric is satisfied, then you are in a regime where you can kind of talk about how do you test such chips, what sort of metrics we should be using for design and test.
So put your management hat on. Is this going to be a viable technique? Suppose I have an idea that can take advantage of a 10x power saving, and I want to use this stuff in the same way that gallium arsenide is obviously better than silicon, except for not in the marketplace. How long is it going to take for something?
Yes, time to market. That's your question. I think.
Well, it's more complicated than time to market.
Yeah.
It's your example of an ECG, that's medical, and so I've got lawsuits to worry about. Right? So I have to have a smart person make the decision.
Yeah. Well, let's take this question offline because there are many different answers one can give. In my view, this is. Whenever you are looking at a problem, a particular topic that has been around for such a long time, and you're saying that now we are going to look at it differently, then I think there will be some time lag. I think this particular way of looking at information processing touches all the different design levels of the design hierarchy. So it requires some coordinated effort between these different communities. So I don't want to put, it's very hard for me to give a solid answer to that question as to when can I bring it into the market. Now, we do have prototype chips, and I hope we'll have more in the future that show that these techniques are, in a limited context, we can actually build things today. So this is what I would say.
The good news is it's CMOS.
And also you can use these techniques if you have some error checking, right? That means that you can replay or some other mechanisms.
Right, right. That's right.
Okay.
Anybody else?